Hello, so this is video regarding the spinal cord tumor. Important to mention here that this is the tumors of the neural tissue and there is no involvement of the bone in this. So this is not the vertebral column tumor, this is the spinal cord tumors. So to classify it, we should know the normal anatomy. So this is the cross section of the spinal cord. So this entire is the spinal cord, which includes a medullary tissue. Outside we have the meninges, we have the, from inside to outside we have the pia mater, arachnoid mater and the dura mater. So any lesion that is outside the dura mater is known as the extradural. Any lesion that is inside the dura mater is the intradural. Now intradural can be of two types. It can be intradural, but extramedullary means in the region of pia mater and the arachnoid mater, or it can be intradural and intramedullary in the medullary tissue itself. So we have classification, we have the intradural and extramedullary, intradural and intramedullary and the extradural. So to more elaborate it, so as we can see, this is a cross section including the vertebral bone. So this tissue is the dura mater. So anything that is inside it, it is intradural, and anything that is outside, it is the extradural. So inside can be, again, it can be intradural or extramedullary, or it can be intramedullary and intradural. So to what all included in the these tumor types, to begin with, we will begin with the extradural types. So as we know that outside the dura, we have the vertebra, we have the epidural space. So what our tumors are here, so most common is the metastasis, primary or secondary, where we have the lymphoma, we have the epidural abscess, epidural lesions, and we have the vertebral lesions. Then we have the intradural and the extramedullary. So intradural and extramedullary include the tumors in this region, in the pia mater and the arachnoid mater. So what all is in this region, we have that dorsal root ganglion and we have the meninges. So tumors arising from the dorsal root and the meninges will be included in the intradural and the extramedullary. So what arises from the dorsal root, we have a tumor known as schwannoma, which is most common type of this tumor, seen in 40-50 years age group. Male female incidence is equal, arises from the dorsal root and it is S100 positive. Then we have the meninges in this region. So another common tumor in this region is meningioma, which is mostly seen in women, about 80%. Site of involvement is the thoracic spine. Age group is the same, 50-60 year, and it is associated with the neurofibromatosis type 2. Now to come with the intradural and the intramedullary, means in this region we have the two tumors most common. We have the ependymoma, which can be benign and malignant. Depending on the histopathology, it can be mixopapillary and the cellular. Another important mention is about the astrocytoma in this region, which is mostly benign, seen in children, and it involves the cervicothoracic junction. So important thing about the spinal cord tumor is not all the tumors, but the differentiating features between the extramedullary and the intramedullary. Now to study the differentiating feature between extra and intramedullary, we should know the what all is included in the medullary tissue. So as we know, in the cross section of the spinal cord, we have the various tracts. We have the posteriorly dorsal column, which carries the deep touch, which carries the proprioception and vibration. Then we have the lateral spinothalamic tract. Lateral spinothalamic tract, it carries the pain and temperature. Then we have the ventral spinothalamic tract, which carries the fine touch. So this was about the sensory part. So as we can see that orientation, the cervical is the most middle one, thoracic, lumbar and the sacral. Sacral is the most lateral most one. So this is in the lateral spinothalamic tract. So in the motor section, we have the lateral corticospinal tract and the ventral corticospinal tract. So again in the lateral corticospinal tract, we have the medial is the cervical, thoracic, lumbar and the sacral. So with this, we will study about the various differential features between the extra and the intramedullary. So this chart shows us the various differentiating features. To begin with the motor type. So to begin with the extramedullary and intramedullary differentiating features. So firstly, UMN sign is most common in the extramedullary because cortical spinal tract, it is lateral corticospinal tract. So they are located laterally. So they are more likely to be compressed from the lateral side than from the medial side. So we have a more earlier involvement of the lateral corticospinal tract. So that's why UMN sign are more common in the extramedullary, whereas in intramedullary there is late involvement of the corticospinal tract. So it is a late feature. About the LMN sign, lower motor neuron sign. So only 1 to 2 segment at the site of compression. As we know that it is extramedullary. So it can compress a root also. So once the root is compressed, it will show a lower motor neuron signs. Whereas in intramedullary, they are more common. Lower motor neuron sign are more common and they are wide distribution. So UMN sign are more common in the extramedullary, whereas LMN sign are more common in the intramedullary. Coming to the sensory. So pain, as it is extramedullary, it is more likely to involve the roots, nerve roots. So root pain is more common. Radicular pain is more common in the extramedullary, whereas in case of intramedullary, there is a funicular pain. Funicular dull aching pain will be seen in the intramedullary. About the dissociative sensory loss. So it is, what means by the dissociative sensory loss is that a part of the tract will be involved. One tract will be involved while the other will be spared. Supposedly if there is tumor in this region, so it will involve the lateral spinothalamic tract. Means the pain and temperature part will be involved. But dorsal will be spared. Means the proprioception and the vibration, crude touch will be spared. So this is mostly seen in the intramedullary case. So dissociative sensory loss, that is a part of the sensation is involved while a part is preserved. So this is mostly seen in intramedullary. About the sacral sensation. So as we know, the sacral sensation, they are lateral most. So they are most likely involved in case of the extramedullary. Whereas in intramedullary, there will be sparing of the sacral sensation. So sacral sensation, so they are lost in extramedullary because they are earlier involved as they are laterally placed. Whereas intramedullary, there is a sacral sensation preservation. So sacral anesthesia will mostly seen in the extramedullary. So extramedullary will show a choroichoina like signs and symptoms. About the joint sensation. So joint sensation is in the dorsal column. So again, joint sensation will be lost in extramedullary because it is posteriorly placed. So any posterior tumor will more likely involve the joint sensation. In intramedullary, there will be late involvement. So tumor will take time to reach the posterior column. So there is a Lehrmann sign. We know that sudden flexion of the neck will produce a radiating pain. So as we know, radiating pain is seen in the extramedullary because it is most likely to involve the nerve root. So Lehrmann sign will be present in the extramedullary, whereas it is absent in the intramedullary. Now about the bowel and bladder. Bowel and bladder will be earlier involved in the intramedullary, whereas in extramedullary it will be late involvement. So this was about the extramedullary and intramedullary differences. To add on in these differential features, we have other features. Some are repetitive. We know radicular pain is more in extramedullary. Vertebral pain will be more in the extramedullary. Funicular pain will be more in the intramedullary. UMN sign will be in the extramedullary because lateral corticospinal tracts are involved earlier in extramedullary. LMN sign are prominent in the intramedullary. Paresthesia, now this is the important point. It is a descending progression. Means cervical will be involved first and sacral is involved last. because of this placement. So intramedullary, cervical is involved, then thoracic, then lumbar, then sacral. So it is descending. Whereas in case of the extramedullary, it is ascending, because sacral is involved first, then lumbar, then thoracic, then cervical. So this was about the paresthesia. Sphincter, bowel and bladder, it is involved in earlier in intramedullary, and trophic changes are also common in intramedullary. So this was about the differences between intra and extramedullary. Now a word about the intradural and the extradural. So we know in the extradural we have the metastasis, lymphoma, epidural and the vertebral lesions. So we have the mode of onset. Intradural, it will be more asymmetrical, acute and malignant, whereas extradural, it will be symmetrical, slow and progressive, benign. Vertebral, in intradural there is no vertebral involvement, so no pain, no gibbous. Extradural may involve the vertebral column and there will be associated pain and the gibbous in extradural lesions. So this was about the various differences between the extradural and the intradural, and further between the extramedullary and the intramedullary. So important thing to remember is how these tracts are placed, what they control, and a brief enumeration of the various tumors. Thank you.